Hi, I'm Mamta. Continuing chapter 4, Human Development, we've understood about prenatal stage and infancy. Let's look at childhood now. When we talk about childhood, we understand that the growth of a child is relatively slow as compared to infancy. It's a relatively stable phase, although the child from early childhood is learning a lot, but as compared to infancy, it is relatively slow. The child develops physically, gains height and weight, learns to walk, learns to run. So a lot of milestones in speech as well as in motor development are being accomplished. And the child is able to play, jump, run around, is able to expand his world right from the parents and the family to other adults at around home and school. Now, talking about the physical development, we have two important principles. First is cephalocaudal development. Cephalocaudal development proceeds from the cephalic region, that is the head region, to the caudal region, that is the tail region, that is the feet. Now, children, if you ever observe, gain control of the head muscles first, and then they start using their arms for crawling, and then they start using their feet for crawling. So also when you observe them, the head is proportionately larger than the rest of the body. As the child grows up, the rest of the body slims down in line and in proportion to the head. Second principle that we have is the proximodistal development. Proximodistal means the development takes place from the center of the body and then takes place towards the extremities. So whenever you notice any child, he will first turn around completely to take in whatever he wants and then start using the precise hands and legs. So the distance from the torso or the center abdomen, and then the development goes on to the extreme parts of the body, that is the hands and the legs. Next, we have the motor development. Motor development, normally the child is able to use his hands and legs in a very precise manner. So when we look at a very young child, he will pick up a ball with the total hand muscles. He will use blocks to play around with. But later on, he will start with the use of pencil, a very precise movement. So this is known as the fine motor movement. That was the gross movement. Fine would also be the use of different puzzles, because in puzzles also, the fine motor dexterity is being used. Now here, the child is also able to move around with confidence and a purpose. There's always a goal in the mind of the child. It is not a random movement like an infant does. It's a very, very purposeful and a goal-oriented movement that a child makes. So fine motor skills develop, unlike reflexes in infancy. Fine motor skills develop, dexterity, the eye-hand coordination improve. The child is able to tie the shoelaces. The child, this is the aspect of eye-hand coordination, where the child is able to use the eye and the hand and coordinate the movement together. Next and very important we have is the cognitive development. Let's look at what Jean Piaget says about child's growth. Now, when we say childhood, we have the age from 2 to 7 years. That is one stage we call as the pre-operational stage according to Jean Piaget. And then we have 7 to 11 years. These two stages, which is concrete operational stage, come in childhood as an ability, cognitive development. Now this ability, when we talk about pre-operational, operations and operations before something happens and then operation happens. So operation is basically a thought, it's a symbolic thought where a person is able to remember things. So if I tell a child to draw a tree, do you think the child will be able to draw a tree? It is possible, of course, because we are talking about symbols which are represented in the mind in the form of images. The child remembers and expands his mental world to incorporate the environment. Now, this feature particularly is there in pre-operational stage. We also have a lot of other sub-characteristics in the pre-operational stage, which then develop finally in the concrete operational or the next stage. We have one concept called egocentrism. It's not ego exactly. It's basically that the child is focusing all his attention on himself. So what he thinks is right. The perspective that he has is right. He is only able to appreciate his own point of view. He is able to look at the world only in his perspective. So it is self-focus. Let's look at an example. A small child falls down on the ground or hits a table. Normally, the child will say, "The road hit me," or "The table hit me." That is the concept of egocentrism, where the child is only able to look at things from his own perspective. Then we have another concept called animism. Animism is the thinking that all the other things which are non-living also are living. That is what the child assumes, that like my own self, the outside things, the non-living things also have a self in them. For example, we say the concept of Chanda Mama. Now, obviously the moon is a non-living object, but we attribute human-like qualities to it, living qualities to it. That is also known as personification in English. Let's look at the next very important feature, which is there in the pre-operational stage, which we call as centration. Now, this is a tendency of a child to focus on a single characteristic feature of an object or an event. For example, the child says, "I want to have water from this big glass and not from a wide object." Now, obviously, because the child is only looking at the height and not looking at the width and the depth, the child can only take in one feature and not combine and understand that one feature can get converted into the other. A lot of experiments were done where it was done in front of the child that from a large box, from a large tank, the water was transferred in front of a child into another container, which was a little deep and wide. Now, the child was asked that is the water content same in both? Now, surprisingly, the child's reply was that no, the water content is more in the taller glass, the larger glass. Even if in front of the child it is done, still, because the child is not able to focus on the height, the width and the breadth simultaneously, that is why the child assumes this. A lot of such examples are there in our daily life. A child is asked, "This girl, is she a daughter? Is she a sister? Is she a friend? Is she a student?" The child will say, "No, she is just my sister. She is not the other things." So the other characteristics are not understood in the pre-operational stage. Similarly, if we tell a child, "Is it yellow colored flowers? Are the flowers more or are the yellow colors more?" Now, here also the child gets confused because both the aspects are not being incorporated by the child. Now, these factors that we've understood automatically change when we move on to the concrete operational stage. Because in this stage, the child is able to develop cognitively and he's able to use the concrete objects outside. He's able to represent them in the mind. Now, this child in concrete operational stage, the next stage according to Jean Piaget, from 7 years to 11 years, will not have egocentrism. Centration will get over and the child will incorporate a lot of characteristics together, and also animism will also get over because now the child understands the difference between a living object and a non-living object. Now, in this stage, we are talking about a very intuitive thought. Dealing with operations, there is no logic to it. It is only the mental actions that allow the child to do mentally what was done physically before. So whatever is seen outside is now represented in the brain. For instance, a child is asked the steps of making a certain food like Maggie. The child not just doing it, but can mentally also tell you the whole procedure and the whole process. Also, there's a feature called as reversibility, where the child is able to reverse the steps from the final outcome to the first step. This is a very important feature here. Let's look at the socio-emotional development now. society-wise and emotions-wise, the child is now developing. Now, the child knows who he or she is. The self starts developing. The gender perspective becomes clear. The role of the child in society becomes clear. A child says, I'm always appreciated for my singing. I am always called for maths. So these are the aspects the child is able to get a clarity in. A lot of cooperation. I am very helping. So socialization starts with the family and then goes on to peer and schools. And that is where the child realizes who he or she is in the context of societal setup. Now here we have Erikson's stage, Erik Erikson's stage in social development. He understood the fact that there is a concept called guilt versus initiative. Now a lot of children, they want to try out new things. They want to take initiative. Depending on the parents' response, will they develop socially and emotionally? So if a child starts, let's say, opening up a certain toy, wanting with a curiosity, wanting to know that what is there in this particular toy. So that is initiative. The child is having the courage and the confidence to start up something new, to try out something new. Now suppose the parents start rebuking the child, the parents scold the child that you have broken such a beautiful toy that we got for you. With this, the child will have a lot of guilt in him. So this is the stage where either the guilt starts developing or the initiative and the confidence starts developing. Every stage has two corollaries. One is the positive and one is the negative. Depending on the environment, one will be developed in the child. Next we have is the moral development. This phase where the child is able to distinguish the right from the wrong. The child is able to internalize a lot of values. The child feels guilty for some things that he or she knows is wrong, but still has been done. For example, stealing something or picking up something the child was very tempted by and could not resist and control, or helping somebody at the time of trouble. These are all aspects which are developing the morality in the child. Now, Lawrence Kohlberg has done a lot of research on moral development of children. What he did was, he took up different characters in different stories and he gave those stories to children of different age groups. In the stories, every age group had a different kind of reaction based on the stage of moral development they were at. So very young children would start with the concept of good and bad. I am a good child or I am a bad child. They would behave morally on those contexts. Young child after that would start with the concept of reward and punishment. So if something is rewarded, it is obviously considered as good and right. The other is not right. Heinz was one of the characters which Lawrence Kohlberg used to understand the moral development of children, the way they look at the world in terms of right and wrong. Because obviously at different age group, everybody will have a different view of right and wrong. So in one of the stories, Heinz was one of the characters whose wife was not well. She was suffering from a terminal illness called cancer. And she required medicines urgently. The husband, Heinz, went to a chemist and he was shutting down the shop. The time was late, so he was shutting down the shop. Now, Heinz requested the chemist to give him the medicines. Now, this chemist did not agree because he was getting late. It was time for him to go back. Now, at this stage, children are asked, what is right? What should be done? What should Heinz do? Looking at their reaction, Lawrence Kohlberg developed the different stages of moral development in childhood, where first two phases were talking about what is right and wrong in terms of good and bad and in terms of reward and punishment. That is about moral development in childhood. Let's sum up for today. Today we understood all the kinds of development in childhood. Starting from the emotional development, social development, cognitive development according to Jean Piaget, where we looked at two approaches from the pre-operational to the concrete operational. Then we understood the aspect of physical development in childhood, cephalocaudal and proximodistal. And then talking about finally the motor development, particularly the gross motor development and the fine motor development. That's about it for today. Thank you.